Bumps and bruises, scratches and scrapes, some of the ingredients that a good life makes. But sorrows become success, and as we aim for the top, we will pause if we must, but we will never stop. Welcome to Sim Soul Sessions. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Sim Soul Sessions, the safe space to share your stories. Tonight, we are with top-tier Jamaican artist. I won't even pigeonhole him and say gospel artist. I'm going to say Jamaican artist who was recently signed to international label Sony Records. While he celebrates that success, he's struggling with what's next and living up to the huge expectations now placed on him. Tonight, he shares how he got here and why achieving what he has always wanted to has him wondering whether this is it for his career. Before we talk to Jermaine, though, we're checking in with former guest Angela Grandison, whose strength in the face of losing her son has inspired you who watched that program. Angie joins us via Zoom. Hi, Angie.
Hi, Simone. Hi to your audience as well.
How are you?
I am fabulous. I continue to live in the goodness of God.
Amen, lady. Catch us up now. We have some big news to share, but before we get to the big news, I want to know what it was like being for you here on the show.
I can tell you, Simone, that it has opened floodgates and so much impact is a show that is not on in Jamaica, but I can tell you what stood out for me is this parent from Puerto Rico who saw the story and she met my son. And I mean, not only in Jamaica, as I've said, but the diaspora globally, the show is making such an impact. And I continue to be on the path of healing and the support I've gotten since the show. As a matter of fact, this show it causes, you know, so much different connection. Persons who have not heard from, persons who have actually not seen how many years. So this show is really like a getting together, a coming together, a whole reunion.
Aww.
And I can tell you the support, and I said it on the show and I'll say it again, the support has been epic. Your show is just a boss.
Oh, bless you, Andrew, so much. Let's talk about you now. How are you doing? How are you coping? How are things? How have things been since we caught up? You were doing pretty well when last we saw you. People could not believe that you'd really lost your son and you still had so much joy. What's it like down the road now? Where are you in terms of your coping and your healing?
Okay, so, you know, I've celebrated a major milestone for him. His birthday was in January, that milestone. And it's something that you, the human side of you, and it shows how vulnerable we are. And I decided I'm going to, as a matter of fact, I got such good news on the eve of his birthday from my daughter, who was recently promoted as well. Because she said, guess when God said, I'm going to give you double for your trouble. I am seeing that so much, Simone, and I'm telling you that I'm so elated. So with getting that good news, I was able to survive his birthday. And this, you know, some days are just not necessarily going to be that, but because I know of the promise and I know of the hope and I know of the passion and the inspiration that I am to so many, I just have to continue to go on and with God's strength. And there's a peace, and everybody's seen that at work, that there's a peace and a glow that only God can give.
Passeth all understanding. How's your mommy?
And my mommy's also doing great. She's doing her therapy. She's coming around. As a matter of fact, my mommy looked prettier than me and you put together,
hey,
because she's so well rested. She used to work so hard and now she's getting all the rest and all the attention. And I think she's soaking it up. She has accepted it. So my mother is like my rally call, my cheerleader, to ensure that I'm taken care of this month because it's this, the first anniversary of Nevon's passing.
Yeah, understood. Okay, catch us up now before we go. Let me see your left hand. Mrs. What now? Mrs. What?
And she's a wonder. You look wonderful. I'll paint on that word. So she is a wonder.
Mrs. Wonder.
Yes, yes.
Angie, you got married in December. What a fantastic bit of news. You must be so happy. Congratulations.
Definitely, definitely. I've said it to support that my life, and my daughter said it in the toast. And I don't understand, you know, I should have fetched that toast. That mommy shows that she's so incredibly strong, and she shows that we can find love at any age. Mm-mm. I said, I'm not a geriatric. Mm-mm. Oh, please.
That not
I'm just
sound
ready
good.
To begin my life.
But I hope that is a fact, because, I mean, many of us hope to find it. So if it don't have an age limit, then some of us are celebrating.
Definitely.
Oh, gosh, Angie. Thank you so much. We're glad you're happy. Thank you for sharing your story here and inspiring so many people. We got
Anytime, so much great feedback. And I must also say, Simone, perfect platform. And it really, as I say, that connects all the spirits as a community. The support is tremendous, and you provide that platform. And hats off to you, and long live Sim Soul Session.
Oh, bless your heart. Thank you so much, my friend. Angela Grandison.
You're welcome.
Wonder. Oh, all right. When we come back, we are getting the soul story of recording artist Jermaine Edwards. It's one you will not want to miss. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the show, everybody. So our guest tonight is a fighter. Tell him no. Tell him he can't do something. Oh, boy. You light a fire in him to show you that you are wrong. It's a mindset he has had to develop and cultivate going through life, having people consistently doubt him and having to fight for things that were literally his, but others were trying to claim. Jermaine Edwards is in our big chair tonight. I'm so happy to see you, friend.
I'm happy to be here.
I'm trying to get you in the seat for a while.
I love your outfit.
Oh, thank you. I like yours too.
Thank you.
Now I understand why you couldn't accept our invitation last year, because you were going through something.
Yeah. Yeah.
You're coming off what I think is one of the biggest fights of your professional career
and
of your personal life as well,
right.
which we're going to talk about in a bit. But when I called you to kind of have this pre-talk before the show, you said that things were so good and you understand why, like, some people contemplate just ending it all. It was like a paradox. You were telling me the highs, but there's a huge low.
Yeah.
What do you mean when you said that? You said, I understand
because
some people commit suicide. What do you mean?
I mean, in life, there's so much pressure, and I think the higher you rise in life, the more pressure it is to perform, you know what I mean? Every door that opens can be the exit or the entrance of everybody's career, and it's how you do with the door that's what determines if you are staying or you're leaving or just maintaining mm-hmm. where you are, actually. Mm-hmm.
So you get this big signing note to Sony.
Yeah.
You had Def Jam knocking on your door. You had
Columbia, Universal, every big label you can think
about. And you chose Sony.
Yeah.
And you're telling me that now, in the last couple of weeks, you're not really sleeping, your voice hoarse, because you're working to top that. And I said to you, Jermaine, what is this artist life? Mm. I mean, can you just sit in this for a little bit and enjoy it? It's like you're always chasing that next win. Mm.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at every person who have done anything great, you know, if you look at the life of Usain Bolt, you look at Bob Marley, you look at any major artist, even the life of Tupac, these guys that they stay in the studio like whole night, like just trying to work, get a next song, because the truth is your next song is really what keeps you or bring you to a higher place. You know what I mean? You can either do little less than what you did before, or you can do greater than what you did before. Because everybody wants to be at that, the pinnacle of everything that is going on.
Mm-hmm.
So to be your best you, and you have to be looking at what's going on. You know, one of the things that I don't do is I don't look at everybody in my space. I don't look at everybody even under my levels in the sense of years I've been in the music. But I look at what's going on, because when you're around persons who are in the same field as you, you sometimes, and you're doing well, you know, it might get to your head and you might be comfortable. But when you look and you realize that there are other persons who are doing greater than you, it makes you want to work a little bit harder.
Mm-hmm. And greatness is your hallmark.
Yeah.
You're always striving for it.
Amen.
Always fighting for it. To prove things to yourself,
yeah.
also to prove things to other people. And in large part, that came out of a fractious upbringing with your dad,
mm-hmm.
kind of telling you what you can do and what you can't be. You said he was providing answers for everybody else, but he couldn't provide answers for you because you already had them.
Yeah, I wouldn't say I had all the answers because I would have been a genius.
But you knew what you
But I knew what I wanted. And, you know, it's just, in a, when there's a box that is created and, you know, sometimes people limits you to their knowledge of things. And sometimes when you expose yourself, because one can argue with you based on where they are in life. And they can tell you, no, it is impossible. But other persons are like, that's very easy to do. Mm-hmm. And you have to just sometimes, you know, forget about the things that you know. And try. The Bible says, a wise person always learning. It doesn't make a difference. They say you can't teach an old dog new trick. But the good thing about it is that I'm not a dog. I'm a human being. So until the day I die, I'm still learning.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's just the experience with my father and that, you know, because in the early part of my life, you know, it was a tug and war between my dad. But I can tell you that the reason why I am today, who I am today, is because of those pull to take out and like you put yourself behind in the space of back against the wall and say, all right, is he right? Is he wrong? Is there a open way that you can see? You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So it make you question yourself. I have to be talking to myself a lot.
Mm-hmm. What you say to yourself, Virginia?
Woman said to myself, are you a fool, bro? Or wait. So I would like get, the Bible says in the multitude of counsel, there's wisdom. So you can't really just look at one person's perspective. You have to be Googling. I Google a lot. Like, you know, just to try to find out about the field that I'm in. How do great people succeed? What do they do? Is it that the feeling that you're feeling is a common feeling for people who operate at a different level? Because in the space that I am, I probably would be someone who is not the normal artist per se, because I am the person who makes my music, produce my music.
You do everything.
Write music, marketing.
And that's a part of the stress where you were talking about. You understand why some people just decide to give up, because when all of the pressure comes tumbling down on you, especially in the face of success, and more calls start to come, and you find yourself doing 1,000 things, you start to...
People's journey is based on their destiny, mm-hmm. right? So whatever you go through in your life, the experience that you go through, the people that you meet, the friends that you have, your family members that God give you, sometimes it's not the best in every single thing. How he starts you off is to prepare you for your destiny. So sometimes you may think you need somebody, but God is saying you already have everything you need. You know what I mean? Sometimes you think it's a hand you need, but him say, no, it's not your hand. It's not you just need the brain. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you have the brain, but you need the hands mm-hmm. and legs mm-hmm. to run for you and pick up the stuff. So it's just a matter of understanding your purpose.
Yeah. All right. He understands his purpose. He's fought hard to get here. Let's talk about some of the difficulties he's met upon on that journey when we come back from this break. We'll be right back with Jermaine. Back with Jermaine, I'm going to head back to the relationship with your dad and use that as a platform. Mm. You say when he used to speak with you, he was a leader speaking to a follower sometimes instead of a son, not realizing that he was actually talking to a leader as well.
Yeah.
Break that down.
So the best thing to do, and this is what I've learned even with my band and, you know, having people around me, is to listen to what they say.
Mm-hmm.
So when I'm around them, I act like I don't know nothing. I want to hear your perspective. I would see somebody even trying something because I'm always wanting to learn something new. So even when I know something and I know it work, and somebody wants to show me something new, or I say they're gonna do it a different way, I'll probably just wait until you do your way. And then if it works better, I learn something new. If it took longer, I'm like, you know, say, you could have do it an easier way still, you know what I mean? But at least you can just stop them from trying or stop them from showing you something new. It's better to have a wide range of knowledge. So that's the thing, you know, with leaders. Mm. Sometimes they're just good at what they do and everybody come to them for counsel and they just think that, you know, you're a little bit wise and, you know, you just don't allow people to express themselves the way how they are seeing it.
Mm-hmm. So you knew as a leader early what you wanted. You knew you wanted to get married early, so you told him at 19, Dad, I'm getting married. He said, you're getting what? Well, you can't stay in my house. And you're like, okay, see you later. And you moved out. I mean, he eventually came around to the notion, and you're still married today.
It's not like I knew I wanted to get married. You know, it's just something that happened at that point. And I think also it was a way to leave. Because there was a little bit of tug and war between wanting to do, you know, what I believe in at my age as a boy. And he was like, oh, is it on my way or the highway? And I took the highway. he was a little bit shocked that I took that route because as a young guy in his teens, nobody really chose that route, you know what I mean? But I knew what I wanted and I rebelled a little bit and then realized I was serious. And then, you know, we had a meeting and we scratched out all of those stuff.
You took the highway with him, but you took the long way around to the music, right?
Yeah.
At one point, he wanted to drive a truck that never worked out. You had a car wash that never worked out. You were a teacher of music, but you didn't love it with your whole heart.
No.
But you doubted yourself as a singer.
Right.
You didn't think you could do this?
I still think I'm not even where I should be.
Are you serious? I don't even know.
Yeah, I don't think, I mean, a while ago when the lady who was doing the makeup, she was just telling me about a song, the same song that you love, Don't Call Me, or that helped her when she was in the US. And it, you know, it gripped her life. And I was like, again, thank you for telling me that. You know what I mean? Because, you know, I was at an award show that last night, and, you know, a lady, she gripped my hand and she's like, yo, you see, you special, you know? You know what I mean? And you don't give up, you know? You see, your music, just don't give up. And I don't think they know what they did when they affirm that. It's like people say, you should know that you're doing well or whatever the sort, or you should be confident. I'm a confident person. I'm a go-getter. But sometimes when you doubt yourself, or doubt if you're doing great, it's not doubt that you can do it, but is this the best that you can do? It makes you work harder.
Well, your dad told you that you sounded like you were bawling when you were crying.
Yeah, it sounded like I was crying. That was in the early part of our music, yeah.
Yeah, but Jermaine, you say that self-doubt is a good thing for you. You said it's notion of speaking positivity over your life, and it's really hogwash. That don't work for you.
It doesn't work for me. Yeah, I some people get up in the morning and they say, I'm great, I'm this, I'm that, I'm a superstar.
Affirmations.
And you keep speaking that in your life, but your actions does not match up to what you're seeing over your life. I believe if I say, Jermaine, you're lazy, get up. And it make you get up and do what you're supposed to be doing.
You call yourself lazy? That can't be a good thing.
If you speak the truth about your situation instead of telling yourself a lie, you know what I mean? If you're lazy and you're not...
What about grace with yourself?
Giving myself grace? I don't even know how to... Jack, Jermaine, just go easy on yourself. No, Jermaine, that was good, but you can be better or you can do better. You know what I mean? And it's not a negative. It's not, you know, like you're speaking negative over your life and you just don't move. Obviously, it's been working because if speaking to yourself, looking and realizing that you did not do 100% and you can do better, then it works.
Mm-hmm. You've done really well for yourself.
Thank you.
I asked you about how other Christians have perceived your music. You've gone through some criticism from your own people, you know? Who didn't think you ought to have been driving what you were driving because you should have sold that vehicle and give the money to the poor. Your music not spiritual enough. This deal with Sony, you sold your soul to the devil.
Yeah.
Like, how does it feel to get that kind of criticism from your own?
I mean, if you read the story of Jesus Christ in St. Matthew, it was his own sometimes that criticized him. And it was his own that doubted who he was. And it was own that say he was not spiritual enough. And if whatever I'm doing would somewhat compare to his criticism, then I think I'm doing something good.
Doesn't hurt you?
No.
Did it hurt you initially, or you just kind of had to grow into?
I think that what I appreciate my dad for, because he at the time was my hero in the sense of that person who I looked to for that confirmation. And I think what I went through in my earlier stage, and that's why I'm saying I'm grateful for that, it would have prepared me for people speaking.
Mm-hmm.
What people do when they talk is to make me say, all right, cool, you say that? All right, let me see if you're going to be around in the next whatever. Let me see what's going to happen in the next 2 years, 1 year time, you know what I mean? So it encouraged me.
Yeah. So you've gone through the situation with your dad, which now serves you, because mm-hmm. you have to take the lessons, through the criticism, through the, I mean, things have come at you in your life. And you say to me, Simone, I don't worry about anything. Like, your wife got sick.
Mm-hmm.
Like, sick.
Like,
almost
really sick.
Died sick.
Almost died. Like, and 2 to 3
like,
times.
You were telling her when she was sick, you were like, what are you worried about?
Yeah.
How do you turn off worry?
Oh, I turn off worry is being proactive. If you use the follicles of your brain to be worrying about what you're not sure about going to happen, then you're going to be wasting time. And then you eventually have to fight. I start fighting. So it's called optimism. You know what I mean? So if I'm positive that there is a way, as the song said, God will make a way. If you're positive that God gave you the strength and you don't believe, you fight until it just don't seem no way. And when that day come, if it don't happen, and if death came, I said it was the will of God. It was supposed to happen. If I fought and it just never worked, I am at peace with myself that it happened. But if I'm fighting and I see a ray, I just want to see I look a crack of light. Once you see the crack of light, I see hope. But don't tell me, say, everything is black. Just tell me, still I look a light and I feel like I can, once I see a light, I can bust through.
I love that.
Thank you.
More with Jermaine Tunkum. Just a little bit of light. Welcome back to the show, everybody. Jermaine is still here with us. We alluded to the fact that you just came off a rough fight, a rough time in your career that had essentially to do with someone trying to appropriate mm-hmm. your music,
yeah.
take your credits,
yeah.
and turn the world against you.
Right.
Which they kind of almost succeeded
in. They almost succeeded, but if I had followed through and made my emotion got the best of me, I would have lost out. And that's why sometimes it's best to be patient, because when God creates situations in your life, nobody knew that 10 years after I released a song.
This is a beautiful day.
Beautiful day.
Mm-hmm.
It would have been the fifth most viral song in the world. The little boy who was 10 years old, who sang it, 7 years later, he didn't know that he would have been the most popular boy in the whole world. So the truth of the fact is, he didn't do it. I didn't do it. So that must be God. So if God created the situation, stop fighting with people, not because I didn't give you the license. He wanted the license for the song. And I'm so happy, because sometimes when you see something just getting viral and it meets like 10 million and you almost feel like this is the best thing. And not 10 million on YouTube, but 10 million on a TikTok platform and growing, it would almost make you feel like, hey, right, jump on this because it's going to work. But God said, hold on a little bit until after that. About 4 or 5 other persons did it that surpassed him, got to 66 million, 50 million, and then came the labels mm-hmm. calling. So if I had stopped and took whatever he was offering, I would have given away a lot of my rights.
So the backstory is that somebody did a remix of the tune.
Right.
It went viral.
Went viral, right.
And then this person started to try to say, okay, it's essentially tried to kind of take
yeah.
your...
He tried to say he wanted to use a sample, asking for the clearance, rights, and so forth, and, you know, working out percentage and, like, start to work out the percentage of my own song.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So it's like he thought that we Jamaicans are down here hungry.
Mm-hmm.
And probably he didn't know that the song was Jamaican's corporate favorite song. You know what I mean? So they didn't know. And as a matter of fact, they thought that the little boy wrote the song.
That's Roshan.
That's Roshan. So when they found out now who the person was now, they're like, huh, because he was trying to use a philanthropic kind of vibe to say that, I'm going to give the royalties, all the royalties to this little boy because he deserves it. And, you know, and people were like, no, it's Jermaine's song. You can't do that. So our own Jamaicans didn't even realize that they made it also viral because mm-hmm. they were tagging, sharing because they were proud. But I am happy today that I said no. It came with a little bit, he was upset.
Yes, because then he
literally
went and said,
upset.
You didn't want the song to do, you didn't want him to do the collab and to work with him because you didn't want Roshan,
yeah,
the boy, to get
to make
any
the
money.
Right.
And so this is when everybody turned against you.
Oh,
you
yeah.
You said you had to...
I had to mute my comments on my page. My people were like, killing me, call me something I can't even mention on television. But
you had to take yourself away.
I had to take away. I couldn't sleep in the night. And my eyes were like, you know, I'd wake up in the morning, and even when I black, I still, they're still trying to find ways to comment. They go on YouTube, they say, oh, you're mean, you're selfish, your song was trash. And I mean, they were saying so much different thing to, because this is a moment I should have been enjoying.
Your song is going viral.
Yeah, but I couldn't enjoy. Mm-hmm. So they're like saying, all right, watch out, we're gonna demonize him. And they tried to bully me. And yeah, my team was like, you know, they sent him a cease and desist. He took it down. He did an apology because we pointed out the three lies he told, and he was going to be getting in big trouble for it. And he apologized and took down the post, but hundreds of thousands of persons saw it already. He said he was going to apologize, but he didn't on his platform because he knew what it would have done for him. Mm-hmm. My team said, don't worry about him right now because you have a bigger problem. Because you have to get control of your song. So it became bigger than Malaya's, how big it was, because so much people was doing the remix of it. And then Sony came, and they were the ones who helped me to control the worldwide effect of it. So it brought it back.
Huge fallout. Being at the bottom, you say you were depressed.
Right.
About it.
Yeah.
Came this great blessing.
And enabled me now. So he was saying he wanted to do something for the little boy. What happened now, he couldn't even do a quarter of what I could have done. Mm-hmm. So I gave him a percentage of the master for everybody who did a derivative, because there are like 4 to 5 derivatives that we gave license to. And he gets a percentage of that master, and he also gets a percentage of whatever the music makes in the publishing era.
Until he's
40 year old.
Wow.
Yeah.
So what did this experience teach you?
Patience and allow God to do his thing. Don't fight your battles them when you didn't create them. Just trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not unto your own understanding. But in all your ways, acknowledge him and he will direct your path.
Mm-hmm. But you say there are still some people. So a lot of people now know the truth.
Yeah, some know the truth. I mean, the truth for some would have been in the defense of ensuring that this little poor, they thought it was an African boy, but Roshan is in from St. Elizabeth. So this little poor Jamaican who needs something.
Narrative.
Yeah, the narrative that the other guy painted.
Created.
You know what I mean? So he's comfortable now, but there are still some people who kind of still have me up. For what I don't know, well, I know now, but that's a lie. So they had me up for what? The picture that the guy painted.
And how do you deal with that? Because when I just got into the business and I heard things about myself that were untrue, it would bother me that I couldn't go to every single person who had heard it and say, it's not true, until I realized that this just comes with the business.
It comes with it. I wanted to explain to everybody. My team said, just stop. And I'm happy that I did not. In some time, I mean, we should have, I would have like, you know, a little bit of feelings. You know, I think I should have probably just did a press conference and let the lawyers spoke the truth about it. So, but his platform was big because it was getting viral with the song. You couldn't go back to everybody who it had reached.
Facts.
Yeah. And if we had stopped it, like, for example, the first day he put it out, we should have stopped it then. So it wouldn't get weeks to go out.
But then it wouldn't have gone viral and you wouldn't have had the big international labels calling you. So everything
worked out together for good for those who
for
call
those
I can't
who
do it.
Trust God. Yeah. All right. So I'm sure you had people rallying around you during that very difficult time and who've been rallying around you since you've been doing this, and some of them had something they wanted to say to you. Go ahead, produce.
Guess who? It is your biggest fan. Hi, Jermaine. As we pause today to honor you, I would like to tell you thank you for your contribution to my spiritual walk with God. I reflect back to 2008 when you released your Destiny album. It was your songs, Nothing Else Matters, and Peace in My Soul that left a remarkable impact on my life. I want to tell you thank you. I admire your level of humility and passion and love for the things of Christ. I admire the fact that you haven't changed since the first album, Island Worship 1 and Island Worship 2. I still love you, deserve all the glory, Lord. Today we honor you, Jermaine. Enjoy your day. God bless you.
Jermaine Edwards, pick up yourself, bro. I can proudly stand in front of the entire Jamaica and say there is no other artist like you. You keep us together. You share the love. You share what you have. You make sure everybody is okay, bro. These are your flowers while you're still alive. Yeah, man, take your roses because as a family from the band, we love you.
Well, tell us, I love, respect you. My family and I always continue to give us positive words, encouragement, your wisdom beyond your years, and you always continue to just guide us in the right way. And we just want to honor you today, you know, and tell us how we continue to respect you, always stand for the person that you are, love and appreciate you, brother. Just continue to do great things, yeah? Love.
Jermaine, yeah, don't know you know my boss. Big up, Papa, big up, bro. Yeah, man. It is an honor to know you, sir, to have worked with you for many, many years, creating music and, you know, being your musical director. It really has been a pleasure, sir. I just want to send some love, some appreciation for, you know, for you, you know, my life personally, you know, as a friend and a colleague and everything. Yeah, man. Big ups to you, brother. Every time, you know. Enough respect for me.
Just want to take this time out to say I'm really proud of what Mr. Jermaine Edwards has done for us, and he has made us a better person in life. And we just want to take this time out to tell you thanks really much, and you're more than a big brother to me, and I love that really, really much.
Hey uncle, can you believe that it was a regular day at school? And I was sitting next to my friend Brianna. She usually scrolls through her phone every day on the bus. But this time, she scrolled through her phone and she came across your song. And I was like, that's by my uncle. And she was like, no, it's not. And then I'm like, well, yes it is. But then I stopped because there would not be any trying to convince her because I already knew it would be unbelievable anyway. So I am really proud of you, and I know my whole class probably knows your song because they sing it almost periodically throughout the weeks. So you keep doing what you do, you rock star.
Hi Jermaine, as you know, I have always been a firm believer of you and your ministry. I have watched you grow over the years from the church setting to the Jamaican setting, to the Caribbean setting, to the American setting, and now you are known internationally. I just commend your drive, your determination, your patience, your dreams, your desires, and I just want you to know, we, my family, Ariana, Rowan, and I, and Jordan, we will always be here as your biggest cheerleaders in Georgia. Continue to be you and continue to spread the gospel.
Boy, Jermaine, where do I even start, brother? As I reflect on our journey as brothers, you know, we started at Grandspan Road in Kingston, then to Spanish Town, where we were playing music on pots and pans, you know, playing stockyard, the kids call it freestag these days, in mango trees in the backyard, and of course broke our hands while we were at it a few times, to being the initial musicians at Lighthouse Assembly Ministries, which of course came with a lot of disciplining from Pops when we were not playing the right chords or beats, and then of course playing in the Living Light Singers band, right? Those were some really good days, brother, and but through it all, I always knew you were a special gift to the world, and it is such a joy to see the hard work, the drive, the passion, the determination, the grit exhibited in pursuit of perfecting the talent that was bestowed to you. Your talent has morphed into this amazing phenomenon that is a blessing to so many across the globe. I am tremendously proud of you and for you, Jermaine. Continue to impact the world on this journey we call life. Continued blessings, longevity of life to you and your family. Enough respect to you and big up yourself.
We can say that we're actually really proud of him.
Yeah.
After how far he has come from, like before we were born, he's been pushing and pushing. He never stops. No matter how times may be rough, he's always going.
And always has something positive for the bad times, always encouraging. And I think he's really self-motivated. Mm-hmm. Like he's not motivated by outside sources. He's always, this is what I'm going to do, and
he gets it done.
Yeah, he gets it done.
No matter what it is, always gets it done. Like sometimes it's some really impossible things. Like for me, it seems very impossible, but for him,
yeah,
he's going to do it.
He has a lot of faith, yeah, and believes in what he's capable of doing.
We love you.
We love you, Daddy.
Your parents are very proud of you. You sang a song sometimes ago where you want to make Jesus smile. Well, you did not just made Jesus smile, you made your parents smile. You started playing music when you were a little boy, 5-6 years old, man. You knocked pans around the house. Make a lot of noise. You used to make a lot of noise. But now, you've gone worldwide. May God bless you, son. Continue to be faithful. Keep singing songs of praises unto your God. Bless you, son. Have a good, beautiful day.
I just want to let you know how much we appreciate you. Myself and your dad and the rest of the family. Be that same humble person. I know you will not change. The Lord bless you. Love you, son. Really appreciate you. Bless you.
Some of the folks who've been there in your life as pillars, your daughters, you have a business with them now?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Upholstery?
Upholstery, I mean, you know, we did with the furniture stuff and all of these different things.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it was something that's birthed from COVID. We were just being at home for a while and we just bought this a lot of tools and everything. And it worked.
Mm-hmm.
It worked. Got interviews all over, getting calls and so forth. And I'm happy today to say that it's a part of their business,
mm-hmm,
that is paying their school fees, yeah, colleges and stuff like that. So.
Yeah. Yeah. Emotional to hear Roshan.
Yes, yes, yes.
More than a little, you're more than a big brother.
Yeah, he's such a nice guy, you know. And I'm happy I could have been. God would have blessed both of us together and just met Mafia be his mentor. Because, I mean, as he was the most popular boy in the world, but nobody really cared about him. So I was happy that I could be a blessing to, you know, his family and ensure that we have this bond.
Change his life. All right, when we come back, we'll lead the program with Jermaine. Soon come. All right, back with you to lead the program with Jermaine. You say your aim is to be able to travel the world and do this and get paid to do it across the world, but come back home and give of yourself freely. Mm. What does that look like? What's the ultimate mission?
I think I love Jamaica so much. I mean, I could have migrated and lived anywhere in the world because I have work permits for everywhere. But I love Jamaica so much and I don't like what is going on in the sense of the youths and the negativity and the kind of music that is negatively impacting the guys, you know. And I believe that I can be of a blessing. I don't want to go into a community to ask them for money, to collect an offering. But I would like to go there with big sound system, big lighting, big stage setup, you know, a truckload of like gifts and stuff I could give to them.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible says your gift shall make room for you. And it's not your talent he was talking about. He was actually talking what you give. And if we can open certain hearts in the sense of coming there bearing gifts and coming there to speak a positive word into your life, performing for free with music and so forth, and that's what I really wanted. I don't want to call no corporate entity to sponsor. I would want this same music that I do, you know, bring me all over, make the money so I can come back to evangelize and be a positive influence in my own island.
Mm-hmm. And tell me where you are now in your life. You say you're very happy. You're happy sitting in this moment. I'll be thinking about what's next.
Yeah, yeah.
But you're enjoying.
I think I'm kind of like the creative mind who gets dopamine from creation.
Yes.
So it's like people think, oh, live your life, man, and get a life or enjoy your life. But that's what I enjoy. Some people like binging on Netflix. I just like creating, you know what I mean? And I'll break for a while with my brain and then go back to creating. And when I create something, then that's what gives me the joy.
And you've processed where you are now. You're number 63 on the UK
and
pop,
and the UK
main
pop chart, right? With one of the derivatives of Beautiful Day. And that's a big, not talking about the reggae chart, but the pop chart.
Yeah, but it has you questioning if this is your exit or your entrance.
Yes, sometimes you don't wonder because, you know, you have some things that create a big door and you're wondering if this is the biggest thing that would ever happen to you. And some people can live in the moment and enjoy it. And living in the moment is cool because that is what keeps your mind balanced. But realizing that after this next 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, what happens? So enjoy, celebrate. Celebrate your accomplishment, celebrate your success, but don't get complacent.
Mm-hmm.
Get up and then know. Use everything that you have garnered in this time to be relevant in the next 3 months' time.
Mm, that's a lot of pressure.
Yeah.
It's a lot of pressure.
A whole lot.
But you're up to it.
I am. Mm-hmm. Ready to fight for it.
Of course you are. Mm. So as we leave, your word to me was that we are all equipped to do whatever we want to do in this life.
Mm.
And for anybody who alludes to, but I come from here, or you're mashing down that line.
Mm.
What is your word to the folks who feel like they're struggling, that they can't get it right, like they don't have what it takes to be able to go after their dream and have it manifest?
Everything you need, you already have. It's what you want, you don't get yet. So the truth of the fact is, everything you need to be successful, God has given you that. He would have given it from your parents, from your siblings, from your friends that you met. And in this moment, you just need to search inside of you. You might say, I need $500,000, or I need $1 million, or I need some other good friends, or whatever they say. But I can tell you this, if you have a goal that you need to achieve, everything that you need to achieve the goal, you have it already. Just start walking. Negril, walking to Negril from Kingston seems like it's a very, very long walk. But the truth of the fact is, if you're determined to walk to Negril and you strategically start walking in the early mornings or in the nights, when it is cooler, I mean, walking uphill with the sun is totally different. But if you start walking and strategically plan how you're going to walk, in a couple of days or probably a week, you will reach Negril.
Yeah.
So you can't say it is impossible.
Yeah. And the key to what you're saying is just to start.
Start. And ask opinions of others. Because you can't strategize without asking opinions.
Correct. So the key is that we need each other, right? We need people. Thank you so much, Jermaine.
Thank you for having me.
Appreciate it. Thank you for being here. Time for affirmation, folks, to close the show. Our gifts, they are God-given. They come to us and from us as naturally as we breathe. Yet oftentimes we don't see the value in them or their ability to make room for us and put us in rooms we never thought possible. So it is time for us to embrace that which pours out of us in spite of what anyone has to say about your capability. And in spite of whatever you think you can do, listen, when others count you out, count yourself in. Stop running from your gift and run into it. And then watch the divine do his thing as the stars start to align and purpose is achieved. It is not always an easy decision, but the most important decisions usually are not. And it won't always be a smooth road, but which journey worth living ever is. Success will take time and patience, but that is how any successful process works. So give the worry to God. Go to sleep. Give yourself the joy of using your gift to achieve the greatness of which you are capable. Tonight we are affirming, instead of merely occupying a life I don't love, I choose to live well in the room that my gift has made for me. That is our soul food and our show for this evening. Thank you very much for watching. We're going to be here next week with another story of the power of the human spirit. Until then, every blessing, and please remember to count your blessings. Bye, everybody.